Belinda presents this unabridged recording of A Few Days in the Country and Other Stories, written by Elizabeth Harrower and read by Ulli Birvé. One, the fun of the fair. And then, as if the lightning that ripped the sky apart wasn't enough, the lights round the edge of the swimming pool, and even the three big ones sunk into it on cement piles, went out. At once the solid blackness rang with shrieks and laughter. Only Janet was struck dumb to find that she had been obliterated. It was like nothing so much as that astronomical darkness into which she had been plunged last year when they took out her tonsils. Up to her chin in water, she gave a little squeak of fear and curled her toes into the sandy floor of the pool, entreating them to hang on so that she wouldn't be washed away to the deep end, or out through the pipe that went under the rocks and into the ocean. The Pacific was just over there somewhere, behind her. Where was Uncle Hector? She would call him. Except that she wouldn't. He had only brought her tonight because Auntie had given him 10 shillings, and because Janet had said please 3 times and crossed her heart she wouldn't bother him and Layla. Then when they met Layla, he had said, I know, but I had to, Mum's orders, it's for a birthday. For a long time, at least 10 minutes, Layla said not one word. Someone close to Janet began to giggle. A slow, persistent sound like the pop-pop of an outboard motor. She listened hopefully. Surely no one would laugh like that if anything was wrong. Just the same, under her breath she said, Uncle Hector? And she licked the salt from her crinkled lips. Uncle Hector! The surf roared on the beach and men's voices shouted something about fuses. The last time Janet had seen Uncle Hector was when it began to rain. He and Layla were in the deep end, in and out of the deep end, practicing diving. He called, Duck under and keep dry! Layla laughed, and so did Janet, till the stinging of her shoulders made her drift into deeper water and stand with her back covered up, listening to the rain beating against her bathing cap the way it beat on the windows and roof when she was at home in bed. It was almost cozy. Now, soundlessly and without warning, the lights came on and startled everyone. Janet saw Uncle Hector 5 yards away. Layla was with him. Hello, she said. Where were you? Come on. Uncle Hector spoke to Janet, but looked at Layla. Layla was 19. She had long, dark hair, brown skin, and a red and white bathing costume. Come on, he said again, swimming away with Layla, making the water foam behind him. And laughing now, and splashing and looking all round, Janet followed them out. I was good, Uncle Hector. You'll tell Auntie I was good. Layla was unpinning her hair, wringing out the short skirt of her costume and smiling. Huh? Said Uncle Hector. In the dark and lightning. I was good. You'll tell her? Oh, yeah, I'll tell her. He sniffed, pushed back his hair, then stood, hands on hips, feet apart. Listen, you two. I'll meet you outside the dressing sheds in 5 minutes. 5 minutes. Bully, said Layla, pressing her hands against her wet costume. You just wait?
What for?
He rocked back on his heels. They stood looking at each other so long then, not seeming to notice that they blocked the path round the pool, that Janet, made reckless by the night, cried, For us! You've got to wait for us! Oh, shut up, said Uncle Hector indifferently. And Janet did. She lived with Auntie, who was Hector's mother, and she knew she was a trial. Indeed, she was so far from ideal, in spite of her intentions, that it was suggested in her defence that she'd been born rather badly behaved. Still, today she was 10. Auntie had talked to her seriously and said that she must turn over a new leaf and be good and grateful. And she had things to be grateful for. When he met Janet and his girlfriend, now fully dressed, Uncle Hector said, "We'll go up there for a while." And he pointed to a bluff of land where chains of coloured lights, to which were attached chairs and shrieking girls, soared out over the edge of the cliff. Layla only said, "Okay," and swung her red beach bag, but Uncle Hector seemed content. As they climbed the steps from the swimming pool to the clifftop, he remarked, as if he had arranged it, "It's clearing up." Obediently, the girls looked, saw the storm clouds, spent, tearing away from the moon, racing out to sea. This had been a day of heat, humidity, and choking dust. Now the air was fresh, still warm, but clear and smelling of the sea. They reached the top and wandered into the fair. A boy shrieked past on a flying horse, waving an arm at no one in particular. Behind him, wheeling through the night, sat a middle-aged man, neat and sedate in his navy blue suit. You could see he wasn't on a flying horse for his own pleasure. Perhaps it was to please that girl with blonde curls beside him. Bemused by the brassy gold, the red and white, the streaming hair and glowing faces, Uncle Hector, Layla and Janet stood with the returning crowds and watched. The showman looked at the sky and whistled with relief, stamping on the damp ground. With nasal confidence, they cried, "Roll up and see the world's greatest spectacle. 50 years from now, you'll be able to tell your grandchildren." From every glittering circle, a song ground out, and the noisy, discordant medley rose into a night sky lit by the coloured signs of Totting's Fair. Here, where Janet stood, someone was yodeling an old song about an old cowhand. The bulbs and neon flashed and sparkled, mesmerizing the audience. But slowly, and more slowly, the horses flew. They were returning from the daring horizontal to the vertical. It seemed a pity. Little groups began to drift away. A few people bought tickets from the lady in the red box, but Uncle Hector said, "We'll see the rest first." And with Layla clinging to his arm and Janet following, all eyes, they strolled after the others into the heart of the fair. Dazzled, badgered and bumped, they wound past the sideshows, the wrestlers, sword swallowers, snake charmers. A woman said, emerging from the hypnotist's paper cave, "Yes, I saw him eat it, Eck. But how do we know it was a candle?" Janet longed to hear, but before Eck could speak, she had to go chasing after Uncle Hector, wriggling in and out, looking up to see gleaming teeth bite into hamburgers, faces lost behind drifts of fairy floss. A gang of boys came singing and shouting, arms linked, down the path towards her, and she had to dodge sideways into the jaws of death. Huh? She tilted her face up at the name and the picture, and her mouth opened. Swiftly, she dashed out again and came on Uncle Hector almost at once. Layla's violet scent smelled very sweet, and Uncle Hector was looking at her and laughing in a way that astonished Janet. He seemed so strange, so unlike Uncle Hector. But how lovely it was to see him laugh. And Layla, and all the people. Oh, it was a marvellous birthday night. "Here, hold these while we go on the spider. Here's a hamburger to keep you busy." Spilling shredded lettuce and tomato sauce over her fingers, the warm roll was stuffed in her hand, and in no time, Uncle Hector and Layla were suspended upside down. Janet ate and watched, standing guard over the red beach bag, till Layla screamed. Then, till she saw that they were moving down again, she forgot to chew. "That's my uncle and Layla up there," she wanted to tell the fat lady next to her. Chewing, She rehearsed it. Then she would say, I was 10 today. I went for a swim tonight. The fat lady turned and walked away with a young man. Disappointed, Janet saw the floral figure recede and vanish in the crowd. She licked her fingers.
Look at that,
said Uncle Hector, pointing to three short splashes of sauce down the front of her dress. But Layla said, leave her alone. Pick on someone your own size.
Yeah?
Janet took her damp towel in both hands and scrubbed it ineffectually over her skirt. Undoubtedly, Auntie would notice, and she... They all rode on the Ferris wheel, the razzle-dazzle and the horses. Then limply, Janet waited while the other two threw rubber balls at ducks. She watched the man behind the counter, arms crossed, striped shirt, bent cigarette, while he watched the balls and the ducks. He was so jolly at first, before they bought the balls. A paralyzing yawn overtook her, and she leaned against the side of the booth. But at that moment, Uncle Hector flung away down the path and she and Layla had to run after him. Tossing her long, dark hair over her shoulders, Layla winked at Janet and whispered, listen to this. Then, when they caught him in the space between a tent and a flimsy black building, she said, ranging herself beside Janet, well, no prize, no... And she jerked her head at the black cardboard building. Janet read, Tunnel of Love. Uncle Hector pushed both hands in his pockets and snorted through his nose with exasperation.
Once Uncle Hector won a prize for his friend Elaine, she told Layla. It was a dog with spots, not a real one. Glass.
There was another one of those inexplicable silences. Janet added,
I didn't see it. She told me once.
Uncle Hector, amazingly, seemed pleased. His grin extended even over her. Layla snapped.
Well, what'll we do with her?
She can look at the giant.
He grinned.
He's just next door. Here's sixpence, Jan. Get yourself a ticket and go in and see the giant for a while. We'll meet you later. If you're out first, just wait.
The giant?
But they had disappeared inside the doorway of the tunnel. She felt deserted. A giant, she thought.
Hurry, 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 cried a man in a brown checked suit. The show is about to begin, the greatest romance since Romeo and Juliet. Step up and buy your tickets now. See the greatest giant in the world and his lovely little bride.
He'd said it. Giant. This was where she was supposed to go, all right. Vaguely, Janet shifted her towel to her other arm and rubbed the cold patch it had made on her dress. Clutching a ticket, she gazed at the man.
He said, hurry up there, in you go.
She swallowed.
Yes, but is he?
He's lovely, dear. Hurry, hurry, the show.
It was a small tent. About a quarter of its length was cut off by a curtain behind which, presumably, dwelt the giant and his bride. Overhead hung a battery of bare electric light globes. In front of a low platform, 9 or 10 people stood waiting, talking in whispers. As if from a great distance, they could hear the raucous cries to which they had recently contributed the mechanical music. But now, by virtue of their dark green tickets, they were set not only apart from, but subtly above the crowd. Janet drooped with weariness. There was nothing to see. A wooden pole, 2 wooden chairs. But she looked for a moment or so and then yawned and buried her face in her towel. Jack and the Beanstalk. Jack the Giant Killer, she thought. When she opened her eyes, she saw on the platform, close to her, straight in front of her, a very small woman. She was much smaller than Janet, but not so young. Oh, not young at all.
Under the pink makeup, the little face was hard and wrinkled. On a level, their eyes met, and Janet went cold, then colder, transfixed by the look and by a sudden strange sensation in her chest. The dwarf had never seen her before. The dwarf did not like her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.